Okay, I've just finished off the minor repair to the Arenda 14. The only thing left to do is to put the starter on. Okay, I got a couple flashlights in place to light up the internal workings. Let's take a quick peek. Look inside an Arenda turbojet. Sure spins over nice now. But when we first got this engine, the fuel pumps were making some grinding and crunching noises. Now, smooth as glass. And they are hooked up. Okay, the last step in the repair to the Arenda 14, we're going to put the starter on. Now, quite a few people have asked about electric starters and why they're not used more often. Well, there's a very good reason, and I'm going to show you. In the beginning, jet engines were all started with electric starters. This engine was designed in the late 40s and built in the mid 50s. This particular one was first overhauled in 1960, so it was probably a late 50s production model. Now, it takes a great deal of energy to start a turbine engine. This thing has to be spun to 1500 RPM until the fuel starts burning, and then the starter needs to assist the engine up to about 2000 RPM before it's shut off. Turning a 800 pound rotor in a 10,000 horsepower engine to about 20% of its running RPM takes a lot of energy. So an electric motor has to be big. And here's the starter for the Arenda 14. Weighs about 80 pounds. And all the time this aircraft is flying, this starter motor is here. And this is a small engine. A larger airliner engine would take a much larger starter motor, and all those hundreds of pounds of copper and magnets and wire would just be hanging there all the time on each engine. So that was why, back in the day, air turbine starters were invented, because an air turbine is much, much lighter. There's no copper, there's no coils, there's no wire, and the power source for this is off the aircraft. It's an external power cart, but an electric motor is very heavy compared to an air turbine. So all the modern engines use an air turbine starter to avoid hauling around a great lump of a starter at all times. Now the starter is held on by 6 studs and nuts. A little tricky to get it started. Everything's tight. Very little clearance. There we go. So these bolts, these studs, actually don't just attach the starter. They are what the torque works against to drive the spline. There is no locking mechanism. It's simply these 6 studs, nicely tightened, that the starter, the body is anchored, and then the torque of the main shaft of the starter turns over the engine. Okay, the starter's all torqued up, and the last step is to install this front cover, which has a cushion fitting, diaphragm, rubber gasket. This connects to a duct in the airframe that directs air straight into the starter, because the starter heats up a great deal. They usually have a duty cycle of 3 90-second runs for the starter, and if the engine doesn't start on those, you have to let it cool down for an hour. So electrical starters are very sensitive and very delicate. Once I've finished putting this on, what we're going to do. As we went through all the procedures putting this engine back together, we double checked everything, double checked and triple checked. And before we ship this, I'm going to double check everything again, because being an aircraft engine, there's two things. Sure, somebody's life depends on it, but also you can't just pop the hood and take a look at it. All this complicated stuff on the outside of this engine and the inside, all this stuff is absolutely inaccessible. There are no access doors in the aircraft. And all of this stuff has to work. If it doesn't work, and you want to check it, you have to remove the engine from the aircraft, which is a long, difficult process. You can see right here, see this little wheel and this strut? This is to help guide the engine into the aircraft. It's that tight a fit. So it takes a while to put it in the aircraft and quite a while to take it out. So you want to make sure that there's nothing left undone. Thanks for watching.